today's piece, presentation, is the Indian face of God, shamanic practices among the Tara Umara. Karuna. Meditation is about quieting the mind. And what's the benefit of quieting the mind? The benefit of quieting the mind is to create inner silence.
For what purpose?
The purpose of creating inner silence is to allow true creativity to manifest. All artists and scientists over the world know this. When a scientist gets a great insight, or when an artist is about to create a great work of art, they are aligned in inner silence. You know, the mind, with all its emotions and thoughts and feelings, is usually in an unsettled state. The aim of meditation is to calm down like a glass of dirty water. If you don't stir it, if you don't stir the mind, the mud will slowly settle. To be full, the mystics say, first, you have to become empty. We will now go into a 3-minute meditation, and this is going to be a sort of participative session. You are going to participate. I'm going to ask you to do something really simple, and then maybe a very significant message will be delivered to the spirit and to the spirits all here together. Okay? We are going to meditate listening to the songs of the birds. It's only 3 minutes, and the mind, with its usual tendency, will, you know, a thought comes, you just let it go, and as soon as you come back, you go back to listening to the birds in this glorious morning. We are now, to a certain degree, in an altered state of awareness. We can perceive things that usually the turbulent mind doesn't allow us to perceive. All along the talk, every time I do this signal with my hand, it means connect again to the song of the birds. And that will bring you back to the present moment. And if it's at night that you want to do this exercise, you can listen to the crickets, you can listen to the frogs, or just the natural sounds you may hear. So then when I go like this, everybody makes a brief stop and goes back to the songs of the birds. This is important for this presentation because shaman, the word shaman, may imply something dark. And actually, it is persons who are working in this state of consciousness. A shaman is a healer, and he connects with the spirit, this same spirit, the same Buddhist spirit, and the same Buddhists, the same spirit of the Islamic people and of the Jewish people, he connects there. So right now, we are connected. We are ready to talk in another plane of existence. Let's start by thanking, by a feeling of gratitude, and feel how that fills your heart. To Neil James, who donated this beautiful place for our enjoyment. And let us also extend our gratitude to Jim and to Margaret for making this wonderful moment possible every week. My name is Karuna, and I am a spiritual being temporarily living a human experience. Now, this does not mean that I came to party to this life, and by saying I'm a spiritual being, I am assuring I will continue partying on the next life. Actually, I do not believe in reincarnation. I say to myself, I choose to define myself as a spiritual being, as all of you have the alternative of seeing yourself, because this gives dimension to my life. This gives transcendence to my life. My inner quest began in earnest 10 years ago. I was 55, and I dropped my to-do list for my to-be list. Life took me to India, where on and off I spent 4 years of my life. I landed initially at a meditation place that really surprised me because it looked more like a meth resort than a meditation place. You know, there was this Olympic swimming pool in the shape of a pond. There were tennis courts. There were 3 gourmet restaurants. The meditation chambers were air conditioned. And no comments. You have to take an HBI test before enrolling. So, well, that was not what I expected. You know, when you go on the search for yourself, you're supposed to live in an austere life. What is the matter here? I want to speak to the manager, to the guru, however you call him. So I said to him, this is not what I expected. And he said, lady, you came here to drop all your expectations. And I said, well, this thing about this HBI test, and he said, well, lady, I can sense that you're still looking for Mr. Right in your life. So, since you're dropping all your expectations, and I hope you left all your Catholic upbringing home, well, you know, feel free to experience. So I said, you mean to say that sex is not a sin? And he said, yes, sex is not a sin. Welcome. Okay, after 4 years in India, on and off, because they give you a 6-month visa. So I had to come back home, or I had to go someplace else. So I was just like 6 months of the year in India. I did not stay only in this place, I stayed in many places. After 4 years, I knew it was over. I was fed up with the flies, with the tin plate, you know, with all those rivers of colorful Indians all the time. Hello, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. No, ma'am. And I was ready to come home. I did not know what I had learned. This Walt Disney character, fairy tale character, whom I was supposed to meet in this trip, had definitely not appeared. I just took out my suitcase, threw everything into the suitcase, and I said, like, what did I learn? What was the meaning of all of this? And kind of felt that the meaning would be revealed to me on time. And I said, but what about the Walt Disney character? I mean, where is he? And they said, well, you're going to go back home now. You're going to go to Akihik, and we're going to send you away a wonderful man. But we don't know if you will, if you're ready, you know. Have you dropped all your expectations? No, I mean, yes, yes, I have dropped all my expectations. Okay, then just go along your way and be blessed. Now, regarding the Rarámuri people, and remember, each time I do this signal, we will connect again with the
birds.
The birds. And if we don't hear any birds, we wait until we hear them, okay? Because that brings us to the present moment, okay? So by the end of this presentation, this Tarahumara indigenous, which I on purpose chose to be a very strange picture, you will not see them strange anymore. You will feel a connection with them. How? They go to the same place we go to get their inspiration. Okay, 15,000 years ago or so, all these indigenous tribes came through the Bering Strait down. They took probably a couple of thousands of years to get down here, and they belong to the same Uto-Aztec family of languages that the Hopi Indians and the Comanche Indians, the Yaqui Indians, the Nahuatl tribe, and the Huicholes. So imagine, it's to say they are the same family as the Huicholes. They settled here, they like to live spares. Nobody had told them they are poor. So they lived in happiness and they lived in satisfaction. What did they eat? They ate of the three sisters, which is corn, squash, and beans. That was their food. Sometimes they gathered fruit from the trees. As I told you, they lived scattered in the plains, and they were happy. In 1601, the Spaniards came. Actually, they came 25 years before. But their headache, you know, the Tarahumara's headache, were the missionaries. They came and they said, no, 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 you're not to live scattered. You're to live together. We need to have you together so we can catechize you. So they didn't like to live together. They didn't obey. And then they said, no, 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 you're whatever gods. No, that's not the real thing. You know, this is the real thing. This is the real thing. He died for you in the cross. And they just went like, oh, okay, okay. We'll put our idols inside of here, like in this Huichol cross. We put our idols inside here, and yes, we are worshiping your God, but actually we're worshiping the tree of life, which is the Huichol way of worshiping. Then the Spaniard says, oh, look, these people, you know, the savages, let's make them slaves and go and work into the mines. So they were really, really painful to be with. This lasted until now. This lasts until now, where they are being still dislodged of their land. So for 200 years, they fought back. For 200 years, they fought back. And then they got into a more passive way of resistance. They started retreating into the canyons. The canyons were basically inaccessible, so they found some peace for a while. But now what happens? Now comes the investors, and they say, let's exploit all this amazing beauty, and let's build a complex of hotels at the rim of the canyon. We are going to bring work for the indigenous, which means all these wonderful little girls are going to become our maids, and the water that you guys use in a year, the hotel will use in a day, and this is a very dry land. This is the state of Chihuahua is one-third desert, one-third beautiful plain lines, and another third the mountains. So I forgot to tell you something very important. This is what Einstein says regarding energy. Margaret, you have your, can you read it? I caught you off guard.
Everything is energy, and that's all there is to it. Match the frequency of the reality you want, and you cannot help but get that reality. It can be no other way. This is not philosophy. This is physics.
Einstein. These are words said by Einstein. So the indigenous have retreated all the way into the canyon now. And they still have their own gods. You know, there's this magnificent term, which I hope you remember. It's called syncretism. It is synchronizing their belief, the idol back here, with Christianity. That is what they learned from the Jesuits, who were the priests there. Okay, so now let's go to this group. They number around 70,000 to 120,000. Okay, let me get my glasses so I can read a little paper. I paste it here. So let's say this is Juanito. He does not go to school. Half of Tarahumara children do not go to school, but he learns many useful things. He learns how to plant. He learns how to make little violins for the tourists. He's in contact with nature. His diet is completely organic. They use the goats, they use their manure to fertilize the ground. He is happy. This is his father. He also speaks little Spanish. He's not baptized. Although 95% of all Tarahumara or Rarámuri, as they call themselves, are baptized, 95%. There's only 5% who is not baptized. Now, they, the Tarahumaras or Rarámuris, they call all people who are not Tarahumara Chavochi. Chavochi. That's us. We are all Chavochis. The priests are Chavochis. The foreign tourists are Chavochis. Okay, now the Chavochis, they are the children of the devil.
Yes.
Okay, they bring destruction, they bring separation, they bring disintegration. The devil is the brother of God, according to their mythology. So this older brother, who is the devil, could not breathe life into figures he made out of ashes, because we are the color of ash in the rice. So God, who is the father of the Rarámuri people, of the Tarahumara people, breathed life into the Chavochis as well. So the Chavochis are to be kept at bay. It is not distrust, it is painful experience. This is grandfather. He is not baptized. He's one of the 5% who is not baptized. He lives in the world of the spirit. Life is full of energy. And it is the same energy that animates the plants, and the same energy that is in our hearts. They have covered their face with ashes because they're going to a celebration. And in this celebration, you know, they are going to represent the Chavochi. So that's why they have their face painted in ashes. Now, in the celebrations, sometimes celebrations are in the patio of the houses. This represents, again, their cosmology. So when the shaman arrives to the house to make a healing celebration, the first thing he does is, this will be tezuino. This is a drink they prepare by fermenting corn. It is a sacred drink, and it is slightly inebriating. So the first thing the shaman does, the first thing the shaman does when he arrives is scatter tezuino, which is this sacred drink, in the four corners of the house. You know how indigenous love this four corner mythology, to represent how God planted the tarahumaras all over the Tarahumara Canyon, and they sprouted as corn. Now, corn to Mexico is so very important. Why wouldn't it be a god? You know, we eat from it, and from the other two sisters. They grow together in what we call the milpa. So this is their basic food. So we have the shaman here. Now, I asked Richard last night, what's a shaman, Richard? And he immediately said, a witch doctor. And I said, no. You know, you have to go to the sources, okay? What I've been telling you and what I am going to continue telling you, it all comes from anthropologists, from real good sources. Only the shamans know the meaning behind their symbolism. So this man is the one who knows most, and this other guy is in training. I will read now a few things. How am I doing sound-wise? Excellent. Okay. Raramuri have the color and qualities of earth. They are generous, they are quiet, and they are enduring. Chavochi, they have the color of ash. They are best kept away, like a fire after it has gone down. And they denote filth and fiery dispositions. They denote danger and death, separation and boundary. Now, in the life of the spirit, which is where he lives, there is no separation and boundary. There is no separation with nature. There is no separation with other human beings. We are all one. But the Chavochi want to tell this here, this goes there. Okay? Now, the conception of the soul in the Raramuri mythology is central. Shamans cure by restoring the lost, weakened soul. So shamans are called in when there is a sickness in the house and they have tried home remedies and they haven't worked, and then the shaman comes in and he tries one of the 300 herbs that they have in their pharmacopeia. And all the families together, there is a celebration. Everybody's there because curing is very close to caring. So when somebody's sick, they care for him. If he cannot get better, they call the shaman, and the shaman talks to the sick person to see if his soul has been fractured. And the idea of the shaman is to bring unity again with the person. Sometimes the person is sick because his relationships among the community are not good. And you know, this kind of reminds me of Luisa Hay, or of the, you know, when something hurts, is that something is not well in your life. So the shaman knows this, and he tries to find what might not be working in the person's life, and maybe that is what made him sick. So the shamans cure by restoring the lost, weakened soul. They chant and talk about beautiful things and strength and goodness. Because exposure to that which is bad and ugly can cause illness. Conversely, contact with things deemed beautiful, clear, and good is a way to heal. Chants, this is healing chants, describe landscapes of great beauty and power. They depict beautiful ceremonies atop mountains, the rising crest, the rising sun cresting, the third level of heaven, which is home to the gods. Now, the conception of the world for the Rarámuri or Tarahumara people, they say it's like a stack of tortillas. There are seven levels and they are one on top of the other like a stack of tortillas. The last is heaven on top, and guess what it looks like? It looks like the Tarahumara canyons. That is what heaven is like. Now, what sustains this heaven? The souls of the unbaptized Tarahumara people. They hold the four corners of the world. Now, the Chavochi, their father, is the devil. And he lives in the last three layers, which are underground and which are dark. So when the Chavochi die, they go and join their father down there. So that is maybe why sometimes people look like they put up with us, no? I guess maybe we're mixed blessings for them. Witches. You can identify in their mythology when somebody has been bewitched. How? Because this person is keeping things to himself, basically food, and is not sharing. Among the Tarahumara people, sharing is basic, of course. It had to be a means of survival. When your crop was no good and my crop was good, I will share with you. And when vice versa, you will share with me. When somebody passed away in my family, you will give me a few pesos and a few pesos here and a few pesos there to do the necessary arrangements. So sharing is the basis of their economy. They call that korima. So indigenous might go up to you and say korima, and they don't say thank you, because they feel in the order of the world, it is good to share. Only by sharing we maintain the order of the world. Shamans cure by recovering lost souls. A practice that in psychological terms returns a sense of wholeness to the fractured self. So all the work I did in India that was called transpersonal, which is healing the soul in a state of trance, in a state of meditation, that's the way they heal too. They go into trance with their sacred fermented corn through chanting, and when things get really tough, the shaman takes some peyote. As you know, our mind functions only like, I don't know, 10 or 15% of what its ability. So what happens with this roots that Mother Nature gives us? The mind works to a higher frequency. So the shaman actually can see where the soul is fractured and what can be done to heal. Now, when nothing else works, they go to a Chavochi hospital. What to do? Okay. Shamans emphasize Raranui ideals of sharing, harmony, and mutuality. Their mission is to bring about wholeness in the broadest sense, realigning relations of reciprocity that have become unbalanced. So when somebody gets sick and the shaman is called in, it's because there is an imbalance that needs to be healed. Just like when I was in India and I wanted to see the face of God, and they told me, first you have to heal all your inner fractures, and then you will be able to see the face of God. Because God is how it was called 200 years ago, and now we call it many different ways besides God. Okay, so strained relationships in the community may be weakening the patient, and the tensions can become manifested as body illnesses. I want to close this before we go into the questions, saying that I honor the place in you, which is of love, of truth, of light, and of peace. When you are in that place in you, and I am in that place in me, and they who seem so far away from us are in that place in themselves, we are one. Namaste.
Many of you may have questions, and Karuna will answer your questions. If you would like to speak, raise your hand. Someone will bring you a mic.
Thank you, Karuna, for the very illuminating talk. And I totally agree with your own and their spirituality as far as being or doing is concerned, or having as well. I want to live. I want to do and have only what allows me to live, to be. But I am a Shabochi. I can't help it. And I probably end up in those lower three tortillas that you discussed. However, first a comment. I've read that the Paramori are very fond of, as you mentioned, celebrations, and it's part of their social structure. I also read that men, their men in a lifetime, have to hold three celebrations of such nature. Four. And the women only three.
Three and the women four.
Ah, yeah, that's right. The other way around. And the explanation for the women to hold more was very revealing and made me chuckle, because their explanation is that women are more prone to sinning, and therefore are more dead to the society. Now, as far as the Chavochi society is concerned, I think it would be probably the reverse, as far as I know, that the men in the Chavochi would have to at least have 10 more celebrations than the women, unless the women have been holding out on me and are doing things that they haven't told me. But I have a question. You mentioned the young people.
Let me answer the two first things that you mentioned. You have to go to the sources so that you do not fall into folklore. Women have four souls because they give birth. So they need an extra soul because they have a hard thing ahead of them. And men only have three souls because they do not give birth. That's one thing. Okay.
I understand that they consider their children of age at 14 and tend to marry quite early. And they're the monogamous, I understand. Also, they marry only their own. So when we have societies like that in North America, like the Mennonites, they may go to Central or South America to look for a bride. Being as few as they are, 70 to 120,000, how do they overcome the possibility of inbreeding?
There's probably a lot of inbreeding. And there's this, and some do marry some do marry chavochis or mestizos. Mestizos, you know, that's a mixture of indigenous and people who have blood from other places. They are starting to interbreed with others. And actually, now that the government gives help to the Tarahumara, some mestizo people are saying they are Tarahumaras too. So they, that's the answer.
I have a question about your statement on reincarnation. I think you said you do not believe in that. Did I hear that right?
Yeah.
And I'm curious if you are a spirit enjoying a human experience. I hope you're enjoying it. But having a human experience after or before this lifetime, is it just flatline spirit with no form?
Okay.
It seems contradictory to me.
This is
just
like
curious.
Like a personal question, I will answer it briefly. We have the privilege to be part of the awareness of the universe. We have the privilege of having been born to this experience. We must make the best of it. What happens after death, nobody in all history has come back and told us what happens. So you can choose to believe whatever you want to believe. I just clarified to myself in these past days that we're here, better make the best of it. If the party continues later, we're all for it. If it doesn't, how wonderful to have had this wonderful opportunity to appreciate life in all of its beauty.
How has the book Born to Run impacted this culture, and is it like devastating? Are they going to get over it? What's the impact of that book and that kind of fad that we hear about runners?
They are loving the attention and getting a bit of recognition. They became runners because of all these distances they had to go to visit relatives. So they live high up, so they have developed very strong lungs. And I think they're loving it, and they go to New Mexico for races, and they come and interview them, and they are human beings just like all of us. At last they have something they can do better than the chavochi.
Karuna, thank you so much. You're such a blessing to our community and to the universe, and I honor you. I wanted to ask a question relative to music, most notably drums. In my shamanic studies, drums particularly were very, very important to help induce the meditative state, and I wonder if you would speak to that briefly.
Yes. Jim, I'm going to ask you, would you play track number 4 to hear their drums? They go into trance with dancing, music, drums, the corn thing, and it's... You see, I said, this voice for me, but yeah, and peyote. This voice who came to help us with the drums, it has a much faster pace. Put it out, Jim. Intoxicating corn brew until it's over. It can take 2 weeks to be over, okay? So at certain periods, you can hear the drums all over the canyon. Did I answer your question?
Karuna, thank you so much for your presentation.
Better?
Yes. Several years ago, we visited canyons, and at that time, the life expectancy was 35 years. When we revisited about 8 years ago, we met a psychologist who was overseeing the schools for girls, and they're teaching basic hygiene and nutrition, and the life expectancy is now closer to 56, 57 years old. And yes, I wonder what you think about the impact of having the girls going to schools.
Okay. We still have the Catholic religion trying to teach them how they should live, and the Protestants and the Evangelicals. So these people, these persons, they set up boarding schools for the children to come, learn hygiene and learn all the things that you mentioned, and get also Christianized on the way. And what is the impact to them? Well, the indigenous are starting to wear blue jeans and baseball caps. 95% of the Rarámuri do not have television, do not have electricity. So that means that they have been kept down. They have to get down, boy, down, no? But now they're starting to go to work to the bigger villages, and they started to want things. You know, one Comanche chief once said to Alan Watts from the 70s, philosopher of the 70s, well, what's the matter with you Comanche people? You always seem to want something. Why do you always seem to want something? So now the Rarámuris are starting to want things, and they might want a cell phone, which doesn't work anyway. And they might want things. So what is the impact? It's the same impact with your American Indians and your Canadian Indians. They are the same family. So it's the same impact.
Thank you, Karina. It surprised me that you said that 95% of the Tarahumara have been baptized. My contact with the Tarahumara has been in the canyon itself. What percentage of the people in the canyon have been baptized? And of the 100,000, 130,000 Tarahumara, what percentage are in the village or in the city or Croy and up there? And how many are still in the canyon?
Okay. Let's say 5% are not baptized. Let's say there's 100,000, so 5,000 are not baptized. They are the ones who live farthest away in the canyon. They're the ones who want nothing to do with the Chavochi. So they're basically, the Jesuits did a good job. They're basically baptized. Okay, but the ones that hold the world, they're not baptized. We depend on them.
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. I really appreciate it. I'm wondering, given the history of the white man with every indigenous race around the planet, it clearly has not been a good influence, at least from my perspective. And I'm wondering if the shamans and some of the more realized people in these cultures recognize that the Chavachi are damaged souls and need healing, and that the path of wanting more and more stuff isn't necessarily actually progress. I mean, are they hopefully healing us?
I would say they are compassionate. If in the wrong way, they are enlightened. Because they are enlightened, because they are in contact with the life of the spirit. I would say they are compassionate, and they just see us as the confused, you know? Because in the end, what are the Chavochi doing? Poisoning the water, poisoning the earth, and poisoning the soil. Now, how much more confused can we get?
I would like to be left with some sense of hope. Because the first thing I noticed when I came down here is just what you spoke of. The Mexican children do not lie. they didn't work hard because they have no money, so they have no needs. How can we, as the Gringos, become more like them? More like them, and how can we help them to understand that we would like to be more like them?
Maybe if you meet with them in this place, where we are all equal and we are all one, and you become a child yourself, maybe. Oh, I think you would like that, huh? Okay, bye, chicos.
We're all intrigued by the beautiful items you have on the table, but you haven't talked about it.
Okay. So these are the basketries that the Rarámuri women have found at the tourist club. So they make beautiful baskets. Even they make, you know, really tiny baskets, and they fit one inside another, which is a small work of art. When you go to the Tarahumara Sierra, buy directly from the indigenous. And that's basically what I have. This is the way they dress. I couldn't get Diego and his companion to dress like this, but this is the way they dress. Okay, and they wear a hair fan. The men do. That's basically what I have. I also have a cross, so I talked about that cross there, because in this it goes with that word, but in the syncretism that they do, they cure with a cross. The shaman cures with a cross. Now, regarding peyote, as Margaret kindly reminded me, it's a very potent root. They really reach altered states of awareness, like anybody from the 70s might have experienced with drugs at that time. And what I heard is that you don't have to go through meditation and all that stuff. You arrive directly, and I think it was true. Yeah. You did arrive directly. Okay, we have time for one more question. Now, before you face your question, is Linda from last week's presentation here?
Yes.
Yes.
Hello, Linda.
Hi.
After the lady asked her question, maybe you can share with us what happened after you went into trance last week, and her inner better wisdom said that her problem was procrastination. And her homework was seeing what she could do about it, and she's going to share with us if this state of awareness brought about by trance that brought out that's the problem, procrastination, if it was solved. So, Yerbe.
Yes, what is the possibility of a devil-worshipping Chavochi like me meeting a shaman?
I would tell you, my dear, now that all of us, Chavochis, good and bad, we have turned and looked toward Eastern ways of healing, there are a lot of healers in this community. I believe this man who gave us a talk, Raul Ruiz, yesterday, I believe he's a shaman, and I have met several other shamans. These are people who, when they cure, they are connected. They are curing in the name of something else that is beyond us. So yes, there are several shamans in this community. I think it took anthropologists years to win their confidence so that they would let us know what's going on in their mythology. I don't think it's easy to get to them.
Thank you, Kahuna, very much.
Yeah.
Another shaman, beautiful shaman of our community.
Now, I just want to share a little experience what I had when I visited the Copper Canyon. I was in Creil, which is quite high, and so I did a little hiking tour into the valleys around Creil, and there was a woman in this beautiful dress, and she was taking care of a cow, a group of cows, and she was sitting there totally still. It was a beautiful atmosphere there, and so I hiked, and after 6 hours I came back, and she was exactly in the same place, looking for the cows and watching them and taking care of them and doing nothing. And it was for me like the most peaceful experience I had in my life, because especially when we come off this hectic rushing life, seeing this one, it was just wonderful. I wanted to share that with you.
Thank you.
Well, yeah, she was in the spiritual life. She was communicating with all of nature. They don't have as many as ideas coming and going and feelings and predictions and thoughts. And they're more in this state of mind. So that is the way to communicate. Thank you, Barbara.
Yeah,
we'll. Okay, here's Linda. Take the mic.
Can't avoid it any longer. People are looking. It's a work in progress. I do want to say that I talked about the fact that I hadn't filed my taxes, and that was an example of procrastination that's been with me lately. And I did not get to the tax mail, but I did get to some other mail. So it's an ongoing process, and I'm working on it. And because Raul is my neighbor, I am reminded every time I go out and see him on the street, so it will continue.
Thank you, Lisa. Okay, I think that's going to conclude our session today. Let's give Karuna another hand of appreciation. If you'd like Copper Canyon tour information, you can see Karuna later under the tree over there. So that will conclude today. Remember to turn your cell phones back on if you wish.
Analytical mind, the analytical mind also can be turned
on. Oh, yes, you're supposed to turn back your analytical mind if you want. And what was the other thing?
That's all.
So we hope to see you next week on the topic of neuro-linguistic programming.
I forgot all about the music.